Hey, tribe of journey men and women. So today we are back and lessons that I have learned the hard way, which means I am sharing. Oh, my mom is gonna pass by. Let's pretend she doesn't exist. Where we are sharing the lessons that the experiences that I directly went through, experienced probably some pain and difficulties and challenges, but eventually discovered some cool stuff which helped me evolve and overcome them. And in this one, I will do something that I did already before. We will take a look at my desktop. Oh, so exciting. But trust me, it's gonna be a good one. So we're gonna digest and dissect this guy today. It's a bit shiny. It's another desktop I made. If you don't know what I'm talking about, I'll quickly show you. I have this tradition for a while now. Oh, this is my new one. Shoot, you weren't supposed to see it. Okay, well, that's a good example, I guess. Because I choose a picture which resonates with me, which kind of inspires me and expresses the image that makes me stronger, that empowers me or reminds me what's important for me. So this is Batman, but I'll tell you about this one next time. And then I start writing down whenever I feel like I face adversity, I face a challenge, I look deep and hard for a solution. Like what thought, what insight will inspire me to overcome that, what will be the solution which will help me move and pass through it. And whenever I find that one which really resonates with me and kind of embodies a certain message, I type the text on the picture. And then this is just the beginning. I just started this one. But then, you know, it's going to be like all over the place. And when it's finished, when the space is full, and I kind of feel that I covered like that period, that stage of certain challenges, that I started owning it. And I'm like, okay, now I'm not only intellectually thinking about these things which are written down, but I actually feel like I started embodying them and I'm really practicing them. They're really like, they became part of me. And then I move on to the next one. So in one of the videos, I already covered one of them, but it's been a couple months, I guess, or 2-3 months-ish after I finished that one and started a new one. And as you could see, this is the new one. Let me open it up for you. This is the new one and it's full and packed. There was a lot of stuff there and we're going to dissect it and I will share the most valuable insights that helped me pass through adversity and what each sentence means in this video. So let's get a sip of coffee. And let's get started. So first of all, you see the image of the Batman, and with editing powers, I will probably just put it up for you without using my reflection here. The reason I chose this particular wallpaper, well, first of all, there's obviously, empty space, a lot of empty space there where you can put the text in, but the image itself of Batman, if you don't know yet, I love the character of Batman. There are separate videos about that, why I love him. But in this particular moment, he's kind of in that state of confidence and I'm ready to take this on. And that was kind of the sense that I felt like that's what I need. The first stage, the one which I dissected before, there was a lot of doubt and a lot of hardship. And a lot of confusion, but I kind of started working through that. And in this stage, I felt like, okay, you know what? It's still a tough time. I'm still like a bit confused and a bit lost, and I'm not sure exactly how to deal with this problem, but I'm confident I will. You know, I'm in that stage where no matter what's gonna happen, I will push through it. And that picture in particular kind of reflects for me that. Now, if we look at the specific phrases I wrote down, there's a lot of them, and it's not necessarily in order like here and here. I think I was bouncing back and forth like in this way. But the first one I wrote is be raw, personal, and vulnerable. Basically, the main challenge behind this whole journey was to find and discover my journey that I set out myself for is how to create the biggest possible impact to as many people as I can. And I wasn't sure for quite a while. Now I have a good, clear knowledge of where I can, what I can start with. But at that moment, I was still like in that confusion state and like trying things and seeing what works, seeing what doesn't, and not really being sure, like, how can I deliver the most value? And one of the realizations was that in our society, we are missing authenticity more than less, you know. Like if you look at influencers, a lot of them, which I guess I'm kind of part of that culture, unfortunately, I'm trying not to be like part of that culture, but you know, I guess you could consider me an influencer based on those terms. But like if you look at Instagram ones, and I'm not that good on Instagram, but there's a lot of tendencies to present only the positive side of yourself. And actually PewDiePie, the biggest YouTuber in the world, 60 million followers, I think. I like him, he's a good guy. But then he made once a video, which I really liked, was he was talking about forced positivity. You know, he's all about YouTube, he knows all the biggest YouTubers, and he was criticizing and that he's been through that road himself, that sometimes you get that feeling that if you really want to reach an audience, you need to kind of show only your positive side, you always have to be hyped and energetic. And he was taking up some researchers who were saying that it's actually bad for the psyche, that kind of leads a person to depression. And he was talking that it's a bad way to go, but that's kind of how most influencers are, or people in general. Like turn on Facebook and everyone is sharing only the good sides of their lives. Like, I've been in this trip, look at me and my partner here. And so yeah, you have a lot of those things, which the trouble with that is, first of all, it creates a false impression. It kind of makes you feel like everyone is doing great and you're the only one doing bad. So, and that illusion is unhealthy. But also too, I feel like as a society, we are missing authenticity. We actually, it's important that we would go out there and talk with each other openly about our problems and issues. And the distinguishment there, there's a fine line, which I think it's important to balance on. I'm not suggesting everyone to complain. And it's not something I want to do either, or I should do. I think that's, complaining doesn't work. There are people who complain all over the place, and that's like, that's not really helpful for anyone. But I'm talking about kind of owning your shit, meaning where you're not controlled by your difficulties in your life, and you're not complaining to everyone, you're not crying to everyone about it, but you admit it. You're open that it's there, but you're focusing at the same time, you're admitting it, you're accepting it, you're embracing it, but you're also focusing on something, on the next step. You're not staying in that place, but you're moving to a better place. And I really want to, part of my journey, I realized authenticity and honesty is not, it is a challenge sometimes, you know. Sometimes I talk about things which are not easy to talk about, but it's not that difficult for me to access it. I'm used to being honest with you, and I'm not afraid to share my shit. And I realized it's important that I do that. And that's actually something, in my understanding, in my vision, that's something that actually the world needs. We need more vulnerability. We need more openness to realize that we're all in the same boat. So that's where kind of the idea comes from. I realized if I want to give something valuable to people, I need to be raw, personal, and vulnerable. That's the only way I will really give something unique. Now, so this is where the second sentence comes in: share success and failure, but share it with certainty. Because I did in the past, when I used to run my martial arts journey channel, my main channel, with more than 100,000 subscribers now, I tried a lot of different things in that channel, and sometimes I would admit my mistakes there, which I thought is a good thing to do. I felt like I need to do it. But something I noticed, that if I would go down with a mistake, then people would appreciate it less. Like, people wouldn't find it as valuable if I'd be like, oh, I did this mistake and I did this mistake, then it's all about me. But if we are thinking about offering value to others, it's important that that we would share it objectively. And I guess, you know, you can be emotional about it too, but again, we don't want to make it's not about making yourself into a victim. Instead, it's looking at your challenge with certainty and exploring it together with others, which is, I think, a powerful tool, powerful vehicle. And that's kind of something that I noted down for myself, is that I need to share success and failure, but share it with certainty, so that I shouldn't just go out there and tell about my problems to the world, but instead, even better, is I should share my difficulties when, you know, I have a certain sense of what I learned from it or where I'm going to go with it. So I could talk more about here, but I feel I'm a bit vague. So I hope you got the main kind of idea, and I'll just move on to the next one. The next one is, a lot of change too fast hurts the law of solid ground. Make sure you calculate and take care with change. So this is a powerful one, and it's one I used to bump into constantly in my life, but it's the first time I really found a solution for it. And the quick story, in short ways, when I bumped into all these walls and I realized there's something I'm missing, I'm not sure how to make this happen, I realized I'm missing information, and I dove into books. And for like a couple of weeks, I was just like mad, like crazy. I was reading books from morning till evening and walking my dog with audio books and just all the time learning and gathering information. And one of the books I read was really a really good one, Maxwell, by Maxwell C. something. Anyway, it's 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership, I think. Basically a leadership book. And that book was telling that if the leader changes his direction too many times too quickly, then the people who he's leading start to doubt him. And I noticed that in the past I used to do that mistake. You know, I would be quick about, if I would notice something doesn't work, I would be quick to drop it and then take the new thing. And to a degree, it's a good practice, but also it's a dangerous practice, because that makes people feel like you're uncertain, and it's more difficult for people to trust you. And if I really want to give something valuable to people, I need to make sure that there's a relationship between us of trust and certainty. So that's the reason I wrote down this quote, that I need to make sure that I consider what changes I'm going to make, and I don't rush it. That if I decide that I need to change something, that I would change into it slowly and kind of get everyone together with me, versus just rapidly keep chaotically changing and then making people feel uncertain. Now, this is a great one. If you take a step too far, take 3 steps back. Recollect and then keep moving forward. This one I came up for myself. But it really empowered me and helped me out to realize how to do this. Because again, when I was in the lost and confused state, I felt like, I'm going to try this, I'm going to try that, I'm going to try that. And sometimes I felt I was bombarding people and people who were following my new journey. And they were like, oh, okay, this is a bit too much for us. And they would be uncertain, you know, how to follow along this journey and benefit from it. And when I would catch myself in that moment, there would be a bit of a sense of panic. I'm like, oh shit, I fucked up. I tried too many things too quickly, and now people are confused about what's happening. That's kind of what I did, how I finished my martial arts journey with announcing this journey. It was too quick and too sudden and too much information, and that created a sense of uncertainty in people. So I wanted to make sure that, so what I learned is that if I feel like it's a tendency I have to do too much too quickly, and I realized that when I do that, I should accept that there's a sense of panic, that I'm like, oh crap, I did that again. And then just kind of chill down, come back to something which I'm confident that works, and stay in that realm for a while. Don't go mad, don't go crazy, don't go continue experimenting. You know, for a moment, stick with things that you know that work, settle in, regain your confidence, regain your ground, and then move on. So that really helped me. Another one is, people first need to buy into you, only later comes the vision. Keep working hard to let people trust you. Keep working hard. And by that, the buy into, it's again a quote from the leadership book, which really helped me at the time, at that stage when I was in it. The idea by the writer is that even if your vision is the best, what you're teaching is the best, but people don't trust you or believe in you in this way, you know, as a leader, that you can lead them to where you want to lead them, they will not listen to your vision. That first, you know, it's a quote from him, that they need to buy into you, or meaning they need to develop a relationship of trust. They need to believe that you can take them where you're telling them that you will take them. And I realized that's one of the challenges I was facing. You know, I introduced my new direction so quickly and in kind of a chaotic way that people started losing trust in me or faith that I can do something, because it was so new as well and so awkward, my new direction, the way I announced it, that people were like, well, okay, well, even if some of it sounds good, I will wait and see if this is really real before I, you know, put any effort or thoughts into it or interest. And that's one of the ways I kind of discovered this open sharing. I realized, you know what, instead of coming out with an end product, an idea of, oh, we should all do this together, instead I should come back to the beginning and simply offer something solid, offer something of value, but something that would help us develop a relationship of trust, where you will feel like, okay, I can trust Rokas, I see what he knows, what he's talking about, now let's see where he wants to head to. I realize that's an important step to make if I want to achieve something big with this in the future. So I want to create a culture. Oh, this is a big one. So, okay, well, let's stick with it. I want to create a culture and movement of people who are devoted to becoming their best selves, focusing their lives on serving others according to their strengths. So this is a quote which came to me at the final stages of this period, where I asked myself, so what do I really want to achieve here? And this phrase resonated with me so much. I was like, ah, oh, this is exactly what I want. And that's what I realized, that, again, I want to create a culture and movement. Like, that's my end game. That's what I would really want to fulfill in my life, is to inspire people and kind of create a platform for people where they could, where they would feel inspired to devote themselves to becoming their best selves. Not only for themselves, but also for others. And again, kind of focusing on their strengths to give what they can give best, not to try to copy someone else. So it's a long story and I'm still kind of clarifying this, but that particular line, that particular phrase really inspires me and shows me that that's what I want to aim for. To be honest, I don't know yet exactly how to get there, but I'm taking this journey one step at a time. I'm looking what's the next good step and then taking it. But then that's what I would want to go to. That's what I would want to see in the world. I want to see, that's why I use the word culture. We want to see a lot of people living that way, living not for themselves, not making their lives all about that, but making their lives about themselves as much as everyone else, and aiming to become better so that they could serve better. They could put more value into the world. And I would want that to be like a standard. I would want to make sure that's not an exception where like, oh, look at this guy, he's doing something for the better of everyone. But that would become a standard, that there would be a whole huge movement where it's like a lot of people are doing that, a lot of people are living that way. I think that would dramatically improve our world and our lives if we would have more people who are living not for themselves but for the greater whole. And also I'm inspired by an idea that was presented by Malcolm Gladwell in the book The Tipping Point, a very good book on marketing, but just covers a lot of universal things. The idea behind it, The Tipping Point, is that when there's enough people standing on the other side of the scales start to tip and switch, and something that used to be new becomes the norm. Like, you know, in the past, there were moments where cars were new, you know, with Ford eventually making cars a natural thing to have. Now it's like, oh, you have a car, I have a car as well. But someday it was like, oh, look, he has a car. Now it has become a norm. And that became a norm when enough people, and more people than less, had it. And everyone was like, oh, okay, it's normal to have a car. It's not something exceptional. So that's the tipping point, and that's what I would want to create with this journey as an end game, as an end result, that living for the better of everyone else while devoting yourself to become the best possible version, because that's the only way I believe you can you know, really have significant impact on others, and also playing to your strengths, really, you know, giving something that you're good at which others can't, to make that a norm would be, oh my god, that'd be incredible, that'd be crazy. So that's what I'm gonna slowly move into now. Don't expect or wait for everyone to agree with you. That is the way of Batman. Long story about the Batman part, but basically, as I started publishing your videos and I actually started to discover my voice, I started to feel like, oh, this is actually a great step to develop this journey, and this is where I can make my initial impact and create value, is through these, you know, conversations with you, honest, vulnerable, raw, and personal. One of the first videos I put on, and I had this faith, and I felt like I can really give something valuable for this. At the same time, I got one comment which kind of hit me. It was a comment which tried to prove that I'm actually crazy, you know, that I don't know what I'm doing, and that I'm taking this in the wrong way, I'm doing the wrong thing, and that I should come back to the martial arts journey. And you know, it's, that comment kind of hurt me. And it made me question myself for a moment. I was like, I felt so confident about this new direction, and I felt so strong and solid. And then I read this comment and something bugs me about it. And I was like, oh, crap. Well, because I guess part of me, and I don't want to make this narrative too long, but part of me is, I do want people to be with me. I do want people to see where I'm heading and to move together. And I know that I can't convince everyone, and I know that I can't, you know, help out everyone to understand what I'm aiming for and what is it that I'm doing. But still, it's painful, because also to you as a viewer who's been on my channel for a long time, and I would get comments from him constantly, so there was kind of a sense of a personal relationship, also weird personal relationship, but still. But then when I got this comment, it kind of discouraged me, and for a moment I was like, so man, if he doesn't get me, well, maybe there is a chance I'm failing and I'm not doing the right thing. But then I realized, you know what? No, there was a deeper feeling in me. There was a deeper sense where I know that this is legit. I can see that this is, I don't know the end result yet. I don't know all the ways to do this, but I'm starting to discover them. I'm starting to see people receiving value from what I'm doing. And that's where the phrase came in. Don't expect or wait for everyone to agree with you. That it's not about everyone saying you're doing the right thing. Like even Martin Luther King, you know, he did incredible things, but he got shot. That's because, you know, not everybody agreed with him, and that the same applies to anyone else. I kind of have to remind myself that if somebody disagrees with you and something criticizes you heavily, that doesn't mean it's a bad sign. That in the end, I can't wait for everyone to be with me on the same page before moving on and taking the next steps. So don't expect or wait for everyone to agree with you. That is the way of Batman. And with the Batman part, a short explanation. That's why the character of Batman inspires me in his mythology and the graphic novels and some of the movies. He doesn't wait for everyone to agree with him. Some people hate him, some people criticize him, but he's focused on what he's doing and he's moving on because he knows that's his legacy and he doesn't stop. So that image inspires me. And we have just a few more left, so. Oh, so this is actually, these two relate. So after, you know, the creating of culture and movement, but first I need to prove and establish myself as a trustworthy value giver in this realm. And that's something I kind of, you know, spoke about into the buy into part, is that no matter how much I'm inspired by that idea or concept of creating a culture and movement of people living for the greater whole, I can't go nuts and be hyped about it. It's a mistake I already did in the past, where I just all I do is talk about that, because that is an end result. That's something that needs to be built and developed through time of constant effort and a relationship of trust. Let's have a sip of coffee. And now I have coffee grains all over, but who cares? So that if I really want to create that culture, first of all, I have to have that strong, trusting relationship with you, that you would see what I'm about, that you would trust my words, that you would trust that I'm sincere about what I'm doing, and that we could move on together, that like you could give me feedback when I'm wrong, and you know, that I could tell my mistakes when I make them, but also that, yeah, I would just that you would feel like there is value to listen to what I'm saying, and that I will not give up halfway for doing this, that this is a thing that I'm completely devoted to. All of that trust needs to be developed through action. You need to see me, to a degree, you need to see me doing this again and again and again for years, for a year, for 2 years, for 3 years, not giving up when I face adversity, always doing what I'm saying. And it's important that you would see that I'm really serious about this, and that I will not give up. And then that gives that trust and faith that when the time will come to start creating that culture, creating that movement, you will believe that, you will know that I will not back out, and that you can invest in this and you will not be left alone, because that is intentionally, that's my life's legacy, you know, and I will be with you for this whole journey, and I will work my ass off, and I will put all my effort to make it happen. So that means you can come along on the ride and you can become part of it. And until that trusting relationship is developed, I understand. It's like, you look at it, if I would rush with this and I would be like, oh, let's create this culture and movement. And you'd be like, well, who knows? Maybe Rokas is going to quit the first time he gets a chance to. Or maybe this is, you know, he's crazy. Maybe he's mentally ill and maybe he doesn't know what he's talking about. So it's important to kind of create a trusting relationship before I head there. Okay, last one. Don't be concerned about numbers. Don't be concerned about results. Don't be concerned about adversity. Trust your intuition. And this is a big one, but you know, I'm running out of time and a bit of running out of energy, so I'll just kind of slowly start wrapping it up. But basically what it points out to is that, especially when you're in the game of YouTube, which I will talk more about in the future, you see the statistics and you release a video and you see, oh, this video performed not as good as your other videos, or you didn't get any you know, comments, somebody wrote a really nasty comment saying that you're wrong, and all of that can easily discourage you from making either new videos, but if you're still sticking with it, it can discourage you from creating the same type of content. You can easily come to a conclusion if that video is less watched than the previous video, you're like, oh, okay, that I was really hyped about this direction, but it seems like people don't like it, people don't care about it, I shouldn't do it anymore. But that's a bad way of looking at it, because not all great things will be recognized from day one. To be honest, great things usually get criticized before they get recognized. You know, if something you're doing is not criticized, there is a chance you're not doing the right thing. And that's why I feel it's important to trust the intuition. If you have that feeling like, I really see this as big, I really trust this, and even if the numbers are bad initially and you get adversity and you don't get the results you expected, that doesn't mean you should stop. And as Gary Vee, one of the best social media experts in the world, said, an idea I picked up from him, taking YouTube as an example, which is a direct example for me, before you have released 50 videos, at least 50 videos on that subject, it's too early to question yourself and ask if this is the right direction or this is the wrong direction. And that's a great idea, because you know, sometimes we publish one video, two videos, we try once, twice, thrice, and if it doesn't work, we're like, oh, that's a sign that it's not for me. But no, you should do it at least 50 times, and you should trust your intuition, and you should, you know, keep going. So that's what I reminded, that's what I wrote down for myself, and reminding myself that I should resist the temptation to look at the numbers, to look at the comments and decide whether this is a good direction or not based on that. I should know better deep inside, through my intuition, which is, I believe, a subconscious, you know, employing the gathered intelligence and making decisions. That I should trust that process more than temporary short-term results. And it doesn't mean you shouldn't listen at all to comments or views and numbers, but it shouldn't be primary. And the last one, just do what you know is right, no matter what. that is the way of the Batman. And that's the same, you know, that's kind of the wrap up of the whole wallpaper here, is that it's, again, no matter what happens, no matter how many people disagree with you, if you know that this is right, if your gut tells it to you, if your whole essence tells you this is the right way, you should continue doing, put the blinders on, as Gary Vee says, and just continue doing it. That's what Batman does in his mythology. That's what deeply inspires me, and that's what I want to do. So again, I hope this page was valuable to you and you got some valuable insight as well. Let me know what stuck with you most. Share with me. I always read the comments and I do my best to respond to all of them. But yeah, this was, you know, another part of the journey. And then I'm ready making a new one. And just as a summary to kind of let you know what this was, if I didn't tell you in the beginning. So this desktop is a rotating desktop. Oh, I still have the new one. And so these keep changing. Actually, I'm going to show you the folder. So I have them in a folder. Yeah, there's four of them right now. This one is the one I already covered, the one I just covered, and the one which already feel like I'm embodying. This is a new one which I'm going to work on. This is the first one, which is starting to become old news, but good to remember. And this is my vision board. And these keep changing on my desktop so that whenever I turn on the PC, I would see it and it would remind me what's important, what I learned, what I need to learn. And I would kind of constantly be stimulated to keep on owning this journey. So yeah, simple as that. Let me know what you think. Keep questioning, and I'll see you in the next video.